Now, so we were discussing this step 1, that is extraction of electron from NADH to form O2. Now listen, suppose actually I have represented this statement in the simplest form, okay? I have represented this whole statement in simplest form. Now, can you decipher anything out of this? You cannot. Believe me or not, it's true. You cannot decipher anything out of this, because if I tell you that this whole things are happening in the inner mitochondrial membrane, can you decipher what is going on and where it is going on? Nope. Now listen. Suppose this is the outer mitochondrial membrane, and suppose for the sake of simplicity, this is the inner mitochondrial membrane, okay? Now, this is the magnified version of the inner mitochondrial membrane. Now listen, some proteins, I will obviously draw the detailing of every protein. Now listen, some proteins I'm drawing here, some proteins, and these proteins actually help in, you know, ETS. These are the three proteins. Now listen with all your attention. Can you say that which one is complex 1, complex 2, complex 3? Yes, obviously. This is complex 1, this is complex 2, this is complex 3. Right? Sorry. This is complex 4. Okay? This is complex 4 actually. Now listen. Now listen, problem is we don't understand that it is electron transfer, right? It is electron transfer. Now listen with all your attention. NADH is giving out electron. That means H plus will be there. Now listen, it's not a very correct diagram, but you should understand this first. So electrons will be taken up by these proteins, but you should also understand very carefully that these proteins are separated by some distances. These proteins are separated by some distances. That means, suppose here is your electron, and this, you want to transfer this electron from complex 1 to complex 3. Why not complex 2 is there? I will tell you. Okay. Now, suppose you want to deliver this electron, which your mitochondria have extracted from NADH. If you want to, you know, transport this electron from complex 1 to complex 3, the problem is this, there is gap, there is space available, right? Right? There is a space. But believe me or not, it's true that it's not actually a problem. Why, you know? Because according to physical sciences, we already know that electron can be transferred in vacuum also. Electrons can be transferred in vacuum also. So, electron can be transferred in vacuum, that means electron can easily be transferred from one protein to another, right? Obviously, it's true. But listen with all your attention. There are special carriers between protein 1 and protein 3, that is Q in the first case and cytochrome C in the second case. And now you will tell me why there are special proteins needed when this job can be done by the electron itself. Electron can now, after I told you that electrons can travel in vacuum, that means you already know that electrons have the special property to travel from complex 1 to complex 3 without any help. Suppose you want to go to market, and marketplace from your home is just 2 steps away. Why you will take auto rickshaw? Probably because your legs are broken. That means you can walk, but your legs will pain, right? Right? That's the very basic thing you need to understand. That means, obviously, electrons can go from complex 1 to complex 3 on its own. Obviously, it's true. But the problem is this, the electron transfer rate is very, very low. If you don't use some auto rickshaw here, then the electron transfer rate will significantly decrease. And therefore, ATP synthesis will significantly decrease. Therefore, you will feel lethargic whole day. The very basic thing you need to understand. That means, whenever electron transfer rates are decreased, ATP synthesis rate will be decreased because these two processes are coupled. Okay? Now, whenever you are using specialized proteins which are behaving like cars, now this electron transfer rate increases significantly. Okay? That's why we use these carrier proteins to pass. Now listen. Why? Now the question is, why this NADH, listen, before asking the question, you should understand why I am asking this question. Listen, complex 4 actually produces oxygen, okay? Complex 4 actually produces oxygen, okay? Now you should understand very basic thing, that is, complex 4, you know, produces oxygen. Now you can say that if electron is needed by this fourth protein, then NADH can directly put the electron here, right? That's a very valid question, don't you think? If electron is needed, if electron is only needed, then NADH can directly put its electron in the fourth complex, right? Why not? Can anyone say what is the exact explanation of this particular part? Listen. What I am asking is, electrons are needed for the conversion of oxygen, for the production of oxygen. Now listen, electrons are going from complex 1 to complex 3, complex 4. My question is, why can't NADH directly donate its electron to the complex 4? Why go through this tunnel of, you know, proteins? Why? Now listen. It's possible, obviously, it's possible that NADH will put oxygen here, right? No doubt, yes, it may happen. But actually, mitochondria is actually helping us. Why, you know? Because if electrons are going from complex 1 to Q, then to complex 3, to cytochrome C, then to 4, when electrons are going from this pathway, suppose this is Q, electrons are going from complex 1 to Q, then Q to complex 3, then complex 3 to cytochrome C, then to complex 4, and ultimately it is taken up by oxygen, how I will tell you later. Now listen, when electrons are transferred via this chain, then and then only the most important part of ATP synthesis will be generated, that is proton gradient force or proton motive force will be generated. Proton motive force is one of the reason why electron is transferred via these proteins and not directly to complex 4. Okay, we have already said in step 1 we will actually carry out extraction of electron from NADH to form oxygen. But what is the real reason behind it? I have already told, that is what? Generation of proton motive force, PMF, right? So when electrons are traveling from one complex to another, they are actually helping in the formation of the proton motive force. What is proton motive force? I will tell you later, don't worry. Okay, now, so in the, you know, many exams ask you that what is the sequence of electron transfer, and they give like this, that is complex 1, Q, C1, C, cytochrome C, this is also cytochrome C, this is cytochrome C1, and there to cytochrome oxygen or 4, and then oxygen. This is the correct, you know, correct sequence, right? Whenever your examiner is asking this, give him this answer, because in a moment you will understand, after few, you know, lectures, after few discussions, you will understand that actually this is a wrong concept. Because if you are seeing these type of things, I have also seen like this, that is complex 1, these are the two options, you know, Q, C1, C, cytochrome C, they have not written complex 4, they have written this time A3 oxygen, A3, don't worry, they are complex 4, okay. So this is complex actually 3, this is complex 1. Now listen, if your examiner is asking these things, okay, you will have to tick this option. Obviously it's true, this is happening, but he will never tell something called BL and BH. My goodness, nobody knows this. What is BL and BH? Cytochrome B has two, you know, forms. Cytochrome B, which has low affinity for H plus, for electrons, and cytochrome B, which has high affinity, BH, high affinity for electrons. They will never say this. It is also a part of complex 3. That means, you can expect two pathways. Listen, 1, Q, C1, C, C, A, A3, oxygen, or you can expect 1, Q, C1, C, or B, cytochrome C1, C, B, cytochrome C, A, A3, oxygen. These are the two, you know, probable mixture of, you know, options you will get. Okay? Now, absolutely this is a rubbish thing, don't worry. But in your exams, you may be asked this. Okay? Now, listen. At first, now we will discuss the basic structure and the functioning of complex 1. Then we will discuss the transfer via Q, then we will discuss in details complex 3, then we will discuss via complex cytochrome C, then we will discuss complex 4 in details. Now listen, if you are a first time learner of, you know, this thing, ETS, you should see this thing or understand this thing properly at first. Then according to your need, you should make your own notes and you should write that. But you should understand what is happening, because in many exams, conceptual questions are also being asked from this particular thing, because they have, this ETS has many things. Probably this is one of those chapters which actually you will not understand if you don't have a very clear base of something called oxidation and reduction and chemistry. Okay, now be with me and I will be explaining all these parts in a, you know, series of lectures. Now listen, at first we'll discuss complex 1 and how it operates, okay? At first we'll discuss complex 1. Listen, suppose this is a mitochondria, suppose this board is a mitochondria and this is the inner mitochondrial membrane. For the sake of simplicity, I am omitting the indentations or invaginations, okay? Now listen, this single layer is actually the first lipid layer bilayer, that is, it is made up of these things, okay? Okay? Now, the second line represents the second lipid bilayer, that is, the orientation is opposite, obviously. Okay? Now, I will explain complex 1 now. In great details. Now, listen with all your attention possible. Okay. Now listen. We are getting NADH from glycolysis, TCA cycle, and this NADH is coming from the cytosolic surface to the mitochondrial membrane, mitochondrial outer membrane. They have already crossed the mitochondrial outer membrane. Now, listen, what will happen to this NADH in the mitochondrial inner membrane? Inner membrane. This is the mitochondrial membrane space. Okay. This is the inner membrane. This is the outer membrane, and this is the intermembrane space. Okay. Now listen. What will happen to this NADH? At first, you should know. Now listen. The first complex is there to extract electrons. The first complex is there to extract electrons, right? Now, how does the first complex looks like? That's a very basic question. Listen, the first complex has basic characteristics, that is, it has 34 to 43 polypeptide chains. That means it's a huge protein. It's a huge protein. It has got 34 to 43 polypeptide chains. Okay, it has got 34 to 43 polypeptide chains. Now listen. Crystallographic, you know, suppose if I tell you now, suppose this is a protein. If I tell you now that please give me in detail structure of this particular protein. Suppose this is a protein, and if I say that please give me in detail the structure of this protein. Suppose this protein has a characteristic that it binds the substrate A. Listen with all your attention, you know. Suppose this protein has a peculiar characteristic that is it binds with substrate A and gives substrate B after enzymatic process. Now listen with all your attention. Suppose if I tell you to give me the detailed structure of this particular protein, what will you do? What is the you know, biophysical method which should be used to exactly determine the structure of this protein? X-ray crystallography. Yes, exactly. X-ray crystallography should be done. Now, right? Obviously, in the molecular biology techniques class, we have already discussed this, that X-ray crystallography is the method by which you can exactly say what is the structure, that is where, in which, you know, cleft this A binds and from which cleft this B goes. Now listen, now suppose if I tell you that what is the molecular biology method using which we can exactly say which amino acid is present here, which amino acid is present here, which amino acid, what is the sequence, that is what I am asking is what is the sequence of this protein. If I ask you two things, what is the structure of this protein, the method will be X-ray crystallography. Now if I say what is the amino acid